church, huh?
So.
We just need a couple of the moves.
There you go.
What if he did? Well, probably in Vegas when he sang that song, he probably did that kind of stuff.
Yeah. But,
So, yes, today, Earth. We're talking about Earth. The Earth. I want to start with a quote from Jacques Cousteau.
Oh, yes.
From birth, man carries the weight of gravity on his shoulders. He is bolted to Earth. But man has only to sink beneath the surface, and he is free. Now, of course, Cousteau is talking about the sea. We all know what he did and what his son is continuing to do. And that might be more appropriate to next week's element that I'm talking about, which is water. But I also have realized that we don't have to sink below the ocean to sink below the surface. Because we have a mind that can do it. And we can do it right here on Earth. Earth is our base. Earth is our terra mater, our mother. The terra mater of our existence. Earth is the terra firma, the solid ground of our beliefs. Earth is the terra forma, the system of forming our experiences. You ever see a picture that, there's a famous picture that they took probably from the Gemini, and of course years later as we went into different times in space, a picture of the Earth from space. That pale blue dot, as Carl Sagan says, and I want to read a little bit from Carl Sagan. He said, look again at that dot. So imagine that blue, famous blue dot picture. That's here, that's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived. The aggregate of our joy and suffering is there, is here. Thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines. Every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization. Every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lives there, lives here. On a mote of dust suspended in a sunbeam. But are we truly a mote of dust? Of course, we don't think of that because we're alive here on this planet and on this earth. Let's do a few fun facts about the earth. Many of you have already learned these things. Some of them I didn't know. Of course, we are the third planet from the sun. And we were formed about 4.5 or so, a little more, billions. That's like nothing. 4.5 billion years ago, and I spoke about that last May when I was going through the origins of life. The name comes from Old English and the Germanic. It is the only planet in our solar system that is not named after a Greek or Roman deity. Not sure where Uranus comes from, but anyway. It comes from the Anglo-Saxon word erda, which means ground. And then eventually it went into Middle English and became earth, E-O-R-T-H. We orbit around the sun in 365.256 days. So remember that when you're looking at the calendar. It takes 23 hours, 56 minutes, and 4 seconds for us to rotate on our axis. And interestingly enough, they have discovered that the rotation is gradually growing slower at approximately 17 milliseconds per 100 years, for those who are planning to live that long. That has the effect of lengthening our days. So when you return, if you desire to return to this planet, in about 140 million years, your day will be 25 hours long. So plan ahead. It was once believed to be the center of the universe, the Earth. Of course, we know that's not true. The center of the universe is the youngest son in a Jewish family. To my mother. God bless her. 70% of our surface is covered in water. 70%. 3% of that is fresh water, and 97% is salted. Fun facts. In astrology, Earth signs have a tendency to have an unchangeable routine. They stick to habits that don't necessarily make them happy. Nothing, no talk from you. convinced that they have to stay at a job sometimes because of financial security. They don't want to move on. There's a fear in the Earth sign folk. And that's contrary to both their intelligence and their creativity. They are also said, though, to be wise, stable, sensual, and grounded. They make great gardeners, cooks, and lovers. They're reliable, and they make trustworthy business people. Now, those are tendencies, of course, of people born in the Earth sign, not inevitabilities. Because, you know, as a planet, we keep spinning. And as people on this planet, in a way, we keep spinning. We keep spinning because our mind keeps spinning, because our choices are always there, and we keep spinning through those choices, past those choices, around those choices, back to those choices, however we want to and desire to. Carl Sagan again. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known. Now, Barbara touched on this a little bit, and I know people have been feeling it a lot. I see it on Facebook, I see it on Twitter, and you can see it illustrated on Instagram in many ways. The continued fear in our world, not just because of many idiotic decisions, or decisions that most people believe are idiotic, not only because of how the Earth is responding to our use of it in its intelligence and doing its life by bringing change in the climate that is not great for human or animal life or any sort of life actually at all. But the planet is trying to protect itself, I believe. I believe the planet, just like we are, is an intelligence that expresses itself, just like we do, through its divine expression. So where do our responsibilities begin in this world, in what's happening in this world? Well, it begins, of course, in our mind, in our consciousness. That's obvious. That's, you know, it's not something you wouldn't expect me to say, in our thoughts, in our feelings, and of course, ultimately in our beliefs. But how do we achieve these responsibilities? Now, there's many ways you can achieve it, and this could take this talk in many ways, but the way I want to talk about it, because we're talking about the planet, not just what's going on in it, but our connection to it, we achieve these responsibilities by doing what we've been doing all during the service, which I purposely designed, by what we did through the guided meditation, what we did through what Reverend Barbara shared with us. We get grounded. When we're not grounded, all that stuff out there gets in our way more than it would otherwise. I'm not saying we should ever ignore what's going on out there, of course not. But what can we do about certain things? We can go crazy, we can get super depressed and full of despair when we don't get grounded. Can you be grounded and yet dream? Yes, of course. Can you be grounded and yet be in wonderment? Of course. Can you be grounded and yet delve into your imagination? Even have your head in the clouds, as they say? Yes, of course. You can do all that and still be grounded. Henry David Thoreau said, "In Walden, heaven is under our feet as well as over our heads." And may I say, and add to it, around us and enveloping us. It's time that we ground ourselves to the planet as we reach for the cosmos. We're always talking about, in all New Thought movements, and even in the quote-unquote more traditional religions, we're always talking about, you know, bringing something in, and something in seems to be coming from above, and in our movement, above means the universe, not some heaven versus hell kind of place, but the universe, which actually surrounds us and is below us, as we will sing about later in the gratitude vamp. But what we want to ground to our planet. We want to connect and commune to Mother Earth just as much as we connect and commune to the divine. Because the divine is there. The divine is expressing itself in the ground upon which we walk and live. Now, grounding in electricity has to do with protecting a building, a person, from outside forces. Usually it's lightning or some other electrical force, and it gets grounded to the earth and thus protects the occupants and the building in case of a lightning strike. Grounded in life has to do with protection from outside sources too. Outside sources called the news. Outside sources called those facts about what's happening in the climate, what's happening in the world, what's happening as far as aggression in the world, or even aggression of any kind in our community. Grounding ourselves in life stabilizes us, protects us, centers us, and enlivens us. It doesn't take us away. You know, sometimes you think of somebody being centered and grounded, you know, as this kind of new agey kind of, and then they're walking around like this and at a soft focus all the time. No, I don't. That's not grounded. That's your head in the clouds. And you got to know the difference. Being grounded is not about being practical. It's about being in alignment, in communion with the Mother Earth, firmly connected to Mother Earth, the soil to which we were born to, attached to. Now, how do you know if you're grounded? If you ask the question, you probably aren't. You can see people who aren't grounded. You can see people who aren't in their body, which is another word of saying you're not grounded. You ever drive by somebody, especially somebody coming towards you, and you can tell. That person is driving by rote, and I'm going to get away from them because driving by rote is them not being in their body, not being really aware of what's going on around them. And sometimes we're like that, not in a car, which of course is a little safer unless you're near a cliff or something, but you can tell people who aren't grounded, who are just kind of, you know, just happening. They're just walking. They're just, I'm going to the thing. And they're not there. They're not aware. They're not in the now. They're not present. Now, I want to talk a little bit about earthing. Anybody ever hear of earthing? Earthing actually is a spiritual practice. Earthing has to do with grounding. It has to do with connecting with the ground. You do something very similar as what you do in that I talked about in the guided meditation. Usually your shoes are off and your feet are on grass or on the ground or on sand, not on the street or the sidewalk or your floor. You got to touch nature. This doesn't count. Take your shoes off and you put your feet in the sand or you put your feet in the grass or stick your feet in mud or something. Now, the earthing in electricity is very similar to grounding, where it transfers an electric charge into the planet and releases that energy. So how do we retain calm? How do we retain being centered when there's fires destroying so much right now in Australia, as it has so many times here in our state? When we have tensions, continued tensions, and sometimes heightened tensions in the Middle East, or we just feel the the more common challenges of our finances or our health or something happening at work or at home or in our family, or we just feel weak, fearful because of life's challenges just in general. How do we move forward past this pain, past this hurt, past this embarrassment? We ground. We earth. We start there. And if we don't start there, we second there. Because we may start in doing this. There's no special order in spiritual practice. You find your own special order. But I want to bring into our practice this idea of grounding ourselves to the life force of which this planet is, because it's advantageous and it centers us. And when we are centered in the divine as well as to the planet, we are centered in knowing where wisdom comes from, in being available and open to wisdom coming from divine intelligence, to use our imagination fully and completely and freely and openly. We find ourselves more easily following those four agreements, especially. You know, when you're centered and grounded, what people say about you has so little effect. Not because they don't matter, but because the opinion doesn't affect you. It may inform you. You may do something with it. But you don't personalize it. It's really interesting because I watch myself in this sort of example. I watch myself sometimes or think about it later, you know, when I allow somebody's opinion of me to take effect to me in the way that I feel, you know, sad about it or angry or whatever. Or even the opposite. Dr. Walker used to say, no matter what somebody says to you, compliment or vice versa, or the opposite of a compliment, it doesn't matter. You should accept it the same way. If I get a fantastic notice about something I've done in one paper or a marketing periodical, and another one says the exact opposite, I should take them in the same way. Okay, that's nice. Nice that they came. Nice that they watched. Your life force energy is not grounded through your home, your job, your family, your spouse, no matter how much you love them, how much they're a part of your life, how much of a best friend they are, etc., etc. Your life force energy is not grounded through them. They are a part with you. Your job is a part of you. You are grounded to this Mother Earth, to the Gaia. When you feel out of whack, when temporary situations show up in your life, you stop and you ground. You stop and you earth. You connect yourself back to this planet. It will empower you. It will calm you. It will connect you to who you are. It will even, if you've done that first, it will even make this intentionally easier in a way. Sometimes, don't you find sometimes it's kind of difficult to intentionally connect and commune with spirit? Is that scary for the minister to say? It happens to me. I've talked about in spiritual mind treatments and affirmative prayer, sometimes I'll start them, and you know, whether I go in what order I go doesn't really matter. I'll start them, and I'll get 2-3 sentences in, and I'll go, this is BS. I don't believe a word I'm saying. Stop, start over. Because the first 2 steps, I wasn't connected. Now, I can start over and just go through the affirmative prayer and make that mental and intellectual and then heartfelt connection to the divine, but I can also go this way. I can connect to the earth and go, wait a minute, here I am, I am together, I am Jay, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, and who is that? The divine expression of spirit. By grounding myself, by centering myself. This is something Nietzsche said, speaking of philosophy. Remain true to the earth, my brethren, with the power of your virtue. Let your bestowing love and your knowledge be devoted to be the meaning of the earth. Let it not fly away from the earthly and beat against eternal walls with its wings. Lead, like me, the flown away virtue back to the earth. Yes, back to the body and life, that it may give to the earth its meaning, a human meaning. That's from Thus Spoke Zarathustra. So it's philosophy, ancient philosophy, that Nietzsche brought into our lives. Ground ourselves. That's my message today. Connect to the earth. It's an element of our life. Like the air that I spoke about last week. Earth, the ground, is an element of our life. It's an important part of our life, just as important as the cosmic energy coming through us from the divine. Because it is the divine speaking in a different way to us. When we ground ourselves, we keep ourselves away from fear or the effects of fear. We keep ourselves away from that trembling despair of the news. And I understand it. You know, I get a little less angry and more, it goes back and forth. I was going to say I get a little less angry and more into despair because I find it sad that people are doing things. And then that leads to anger, and that leads to me doing something about it, other than venting. For the planet, we can do things. We can do things at home, and we can do things in the voting booth. We can give our time, talent, and treasure to organizations that are more equipped to fight the good fight. You want, you can go to D.C. and get arrested with Jane Fonda. And then you'll be on Twitter. There are things we can do. We can also, in our connection, in our grounding, in our centering, we can also do prayer. We can do more than just talk about it, be sad about it, be angry about it. We can pray about it. We could know the planet is healed. There was a healing prayer a couple of weeks ago, and then one 3 weeks ago. There was one 3 weeks ago, the second of January that I did at 4:30 in the morning that I took part of. That is an annual thing that was started in the 80s by John Randolph Price. Yes, John Randolph Price, started in the 80s. And it's every year, and it's 4:30 in the morning, unfortunately, in LA time, because it's on Greenwich time in London. And I took part in that, and I could see in the news there was a change the next day, or later that day. There was a healing of sorts. That's powerful. So look out for those things. Find Facebook groups or whatever that connect and do those things together. It's amazing the healing power of millions of people concentrating on the same thing at the same time. There's the most simple way to step into and use your groundedness, your centeredness, to make a statement and to make a difference on this planet, on Earth. Be centered, be grounded. At the same time, you're revealing the divinity in you. Thank you so much. Namaste.